episode right here.
That's good as shut the fuck up.
That nigga. Which is the practice of being aware of your thoughts and feelings in the moment. Mindfulness.
We are mindful that Jetta's brain doesn't exchange any information.
You are now tuned into the Mindful Exchange Podcast, episode
67.
Today we got a couple guests. Lucky me, thank you for stopping through, good brother. It's lucky. This shit is overdue. We've been talking for years about linking up, right?
Yeah, when people don't have me on the side, I'll be wondering why. We here. I'm the guy.
We glad you're here, good
thank
brother.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Nephew Dev, what's good with you? Thank you for coming back. Yo. Had to put the pressure on him.
Yeah, they tried to make me do 50 push-ups.
Yeah. I was stunting on them young boys last night.
I don't know what
you're
looking at me for. I can eat 50 push-ups. You know what I'm saying?
I'm just saying, I'm coming.
Is that a food?
Yeah.
I was triggering because you ain't doing no motherfucking Yeah, but thank y'all for coming through, man. Like,
appreciate it.
It's a beautiful conversation today.
Yeah, man.
Lucky.
Yeah.
How you feeling, brother? How you been? Shit, I ain't seen you in a minute.
Well, first thing first, can we dedicate this
oh,
episode?
Oh, yeah. Who we dedicating it to?
To the lovely, the beautiful Sierra Danielle Rogers. Amazing woman. She changed me in a lot of ways, taught me a lot. And she taught me that love is real out here in the world. Sometimes we go through this life, we run through a whole bunch of girls and stuff like that, and we think we got love or we got unconditional love. That's what I want to say.
So for the people that don't know the circumstances, educate them on who she is and why you choose to dedicate.
All right. So, you know, I've been out here since 2010, running around, you know, lily padding, messing with the snow bunnies, just doing what I do. You know what I mean? And
what's a snow bunny?
Snow bunny. All right. So I get a lot of joy about snow bunnies, right? Yeah. They think it's like has something to do with drugs and it's pretty simple. It's self-evident.
Keep in mind that a lot of people that watch this don't even know us, right? So anything that you tell some of the people, you're going to have to educate them
and give them context.
Yeah,
okay.
Because they don't know.
Well, a snow bunny, when you think of snow, you think of white. You think of pure. When people get married, they have the white gown.
Yeah.
They could be the most sluttiest girl that you know, but they got that white on.
Dude, they're not pure. God damn it.
Right? So you think of purity, right? The guy just shows up, handsome, whatever. So we think of snow, you think of pure. You think of white. When you think of bunnies, we think of if your daughter or your kid came to you saying, Daddy, can I get a bunny? It's cute. When you was in school, they had the little hamster that looks like a bunny, and you think of cute.
Yeah.
So pretty much it's just cute like.
Yeah.
It's not really a big thing, but, you know, they're the druggies. They be like, oh, I'm not a snow bunny. I'm not a cokehead. It has nothing to do with drugs.
Make sure you just decipher that.
Yeah, so she passed away years ago?
She passed away September 17th was the actual official day that she actually passed away. I found out 2 days prior to the death, which would be September 19th. Mm. But she passed away in Texas. Can I get real here or what?
We do whatever the fuck we want to do.
Okay.
You just can't say.
You just can't play copyrighted music.
That's okay. Your copyrighted music.
So this is what I was saying.
You can't talk
right?
about the U-turns.
Oh, yeah. You know what we mean when we say the U-turns.
Nah.
The alphabet.
Alphabet
we
club.
We talk about the alphabet club.
Oh, and Transformers and stuff like
that.
Yeah. And we still do. We just want that.
You gotta word it right. You know what I mean? You still say the U-turns. That's what, you know what I mean?
We're going to keep it real. We're going to keep it. People expect me to keep it real and be honest.
That's why you here, brother.
Yeah, I know.
So, right, the beautiful Sierra, right? You know, when I got, you know, we meet people and, you know, people put their best stuff forward. And everybody got demons and different things that they deal with. And then once we get with them, we learn, do we accept them or do we keep them or whatever? And when I met her, she had a substance abuse with, like, cocaine, right?
Yeah.
But it wasn't like, and I'm not going to say cocaine. Yeah, cocaine pills and stuff like that. And when I came on the scene, you know, it was a big pushback. They were like, well, we know this guy to be, you know, womanizing and the videos and stuff like that. We don't want this for our Sierra, right? And so not knowing that, I came with good intention, good merit, and she...
So when you say they, who would they be?
Her they? Family. Her,
okay, okay.
Her.
Well, I mean, you can't...
No, I'm going to be specific.
I'm just saying, because, you know, that's my niece. Like, directly, that's my niece. That's my wife's niece.
But rightfully so, it's his interaction with her. That
I'm
specific.
Just saying, I understand, but when,
I don't
when
want
you say
no smoke, you do. I'm just saying, hands going.
I'm just saying, when you say family, so, I'm included in that family. So,
no, so the issue, it was,
you know what I mean? Like, say
it was Chris. It was Chris, the immediate. I didn't know you at that time. When you know I say her family, the immediate family that I knew was, I think, of her dad.
Yeah, I'm just, and that's all I'm saying is, you know, I just can't sit here. And no, my wife is going to watch and be like, why you ain't, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that's all I'm saying.
So let me reiterate. When you're right. When you say family can cover, you know, every
broad spectrum.
And y'all have nothing. So y'all get hit with bullets that have nothing to do with y'all. So I'm just going to say names and stuff. And so it was her brother and stuff. It's like, you know, I was cool, but it's like, nah, no, not lucky, you know? And so.
But they thought you were like a part of the detriment?
Well, see, it's funny how.
I know how it goes.
Cause look, we got TikTok, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so I, you know, when you think about that whole TikTok and the video stuff, I used to get a lot of stuff because I knew that videos and stuff, history repeat itself.
Yeah.
I knew podcasting when you think of back in the
days. You was on all of this shit.
Before.
I say you, I don't know if you know my cousin Jarrell MacArthur, but I would say you and him are neck and neck for being like trendsetters when it came to like the media shit.
Yeah, man.
Because people didn't understand. When I started seeing you do shit, I was like, this nigga smart as a motherfucker.
Yeah, you ever have $1 million ideas, but you don't have the resources.
Yeah.
Like, if me and you would have got together when I first came out here.
We would have killed it, sir.
Murdered.
I'm telling you.
You know, we would have murdered. But, you know, to get back, you know, about what was going on, I had the image thing. I get it. Comes with the rapper stuff. You used to be the guy. You know what I'm saying? Still the guy.
Yeah.
You probably still beat him off with a stick, but you're a family man.
I'm in the house, man.
Yeah, you're a good man. I'm saying.
My wife be watching, too.
Yeah, we all in the house.
And she got a pistol permit. I'm no smoke.
Nah, salute to the family. Salute to the... But you can understand how that could be back in the day. Yeah. We're going 20 years back.
Sure, yeah, but I mean, yeah, you know, I mean, like I said, the hard part, and I think we all understand, is like, anybody, if you have a daughter, you're going to look at the nigga, and if you don't get to know somebody, you know what I mean? You're going to make automatic judgments.
So even having a son, you look at, but nowadays, you got to look at their partner, period.
But guess what I did? You know what? I got the win from her. She's like, yeah, my brother gave me a hard time and asked me. I said, I go see him. And I saw him sitting out, you know, I used to live across the street from him. So before I moved in the place where I'm still at now, and I walked up to him.
Like, we could talk.
And I was like, yo, we don't got no issue or nothing, right? Because I assume we're good. You want to know if you have an issue with somebody, you walk in, get hit in the head, you know, you want to know, you know, but,
and I
had a conversation with him, and I told him my intention, or whatever, like on some old school stuff, like you go talk to the dad, and I was like, yo, I said, first of all, this is by accident, I'm a snow bunny lover, you know what I'm saying, I don't even do the Black Jones like that, you know what I'm saying, light skin joints. She had a standard, she, you know, when I was trying to get it, she said, no, I can count on my hand how many guys I've been with, I don't do the first, second, third, fourth date, give up the box. And I go, I'm lucky. You're supposed to get that thing up. You know what I mean? I'm me. So I'm like, things of value is protected. Mm. You know what I mean? So when you have the girls, these beautiful girls out here that be giving it away.
So explain to the people why she will always be special to you and hold a place in your heart that you'll never forget. Because you were adamant at making sure.
Life.
Yeah.
That the main thing is not... You know, the sex stuff, all that stuff is extra.
Yeah.
Life. And I used to be trying to throw money in the beginning, and trying to flash money. She goes, I know what you do. She goes, I'm a manager. I get my money. I was taking care of Corey and this whole family and taking care of his stuff.
Yeah.
So I didn't get with you for your money. I got with you because you was different.
That's why I love my wife, bro, because she never, even when I was in my heyday, that shit did not matter to her. She wanted me to stop doing, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
She always had her own, always was good and...
It's hard. You don't get that.
Nah.
I mean, I think...
Because I've had the opposite, too. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you get infatuated with the opposite because they get infatuated with what you're giving them. And
the lifestyle. Like,
oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody wants to live, even if it's for a brief moment, luxury, you can do whatever you want lifestyle. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Paid affection. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I had a bitch tell me somebody had to spend it. When she said that shit, I was like, oh shit. I never thought that I was the sucker nigga. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It goes down.
She's on point.
She listen, so we move in, something crazy happened. I end up, you know, fighting with, you know, A-Rock and, you know, a whole bunch of people. The house gets raided. All the TVs, all the stuff gets taken out the house. I say, yo, this is it. I said, I didn't know it was going to be this much to go out with you, like to
get what you, all behind
yeah, for the all, relationship. All this stuff. Because my house got robbed. All my old little jewelry.
So when you say raided, you mean like ran up in as opposed to police raid?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We passed it. Yeah. Salute to Chris or whatever. We made up, you know what I'm saying, a long time ago with CC Pass. That's one of the things she wanted. That's my guy, my brother or whatever. And so back then, he caught me, you know what I'm saying? He booked me, you know what I'm saying?
Booked you?
Yeah, some money, my jewelry, some weed and stuff. And so A-Rock and then was with them. And I'm the type of guy, if you connected to somebody, I can get to you, I'm going to get to you.
We all know your ass all over YouTube.
Yeah. But I'm old school. I just believe that. Like,
yeah, yeah.
With these,
yeah.
The worst could happen is I can get beat up.
Yeah, that's some real shit.
That's the worst thing that happened.
And niggas would be afraid of
but
that.
But that would tell me, right?
Yeah.
Step my shit up.
Yeah. It's almost like playing a sport. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you're on the court with somebody busting your ass and you leave the court mad at that individual, that's a you problem.
I'm be mad at me, but I'm be mad at you too. I'm be like, damn, I should have been smart enough to switch off on that nigga, but you just kept abusing me. I'm mad that you just kept doing it.
Like, yo, that nigga nice, man.
Word up. I'm be mad as a bitch, though.
And so you know, the next day, my crib, they, you know, like 40 people, they went through my house.
40?
Yeah, like it was a big deal.
Them niggas was trying to and be so successful that
they,
day.
They mustered the whole house, catch up. They took the TVs out. They took like 20 pairs of sneakers, my fits and all that stuff.
Damn.
And then, the next day, me and Sierra are sitting and she's getting ready to go to work. And I'm like, yo, they took all the money, took everything, took all the weed, everything. I'm like, you can leave. If I'm causing this much, you might just go with your family.
All of that was behind her, or was it like a culmination of different things?
Nah, listen, it happens all the time. I get it.
Living the lifestyle.
Nah, I'm lucky. So it's like, yo, who your man? Lucky me. Lucky. He got you? Yeah.
See, I don't know you. I don't know you to be, like, when we speak of you, it's never, you're providing us, at least me, insight that I don't know anything about.
Because I've always been cool. No, not like in a bad way.
Yeah.
Remember, you got, and I correlate everything to the TikTok thing.
Yeah.
When I came out here, we were talking about demographic and why do I pay attention to numbers? Because everything's about math and deals. And so I'm like, how do I compete?
Let them know you a hood nerd on the low.
Yeah, you have to be smart. I dropped out in ninth grade. You know what I mean? I don't got no GED, no nothing. I never had a state ID.
I got my shit in the county, bro.
Never had a state ID. Never had a driver's license.
What?
Oh, wow. This life that, I'm 42, this life that we live in, they have a preset for us. It doesn't work for everybody.
Facts.
It just doesn't work. I'm in school. They give you cereal with sugar and expect you to sit there and pay attention. Mm. Imagine, give your kid a lollipop at 10 o'clock at night and see if they're going to go to bed.
Yeah.
They're going to go to bed. They're going to be mad as a motherfucker sitting in that bed doing this with the TV off in the dark. I'm talking about. I wish my dad would go to sleep because he's going to hear my phone.
Shit, I got my wife doing the black coffee thing, man, because I stopped doing the sugar and cream years ago.
That's so bitter.
Yeah, but it's an acquired taste, and I use it for the supplementation as opposed to anything else. You know
purpose
what I mean?
Over pleasure.
Yeah. Sure. And sugar, like, if I consume high sugar, bruh, not even high sugar. Like he was saying, what'd you say, a lollipop or some shit? Like, giving a kid, if you give that to an adult that's not accustomed to sugar, you will feel that
same
shit.
Jittery then
you,
thing,
yeah, and you feel weird as fuck.
Well, I learned that through visits. You know, if you're a single dad and you get, they're going to give you, at best, every other weekend.
Yeah.
They think that. But if you did the math on that, if you take away sleep, if for a full year, you're only getting 32, you're only getting 32 days of visitation out of 365 days if you take away the thing. So when you're fighting for family court and they say, yeah, we give you, you pay child support, we give you every other week, people walk out, think they winning. Mm. But in actuality, you only get 36 days of visitation out of 365 days. So you say, all right, cool, why not take that? Our job as fathers is to teach and train. Women, they raise. We don't raise. We train and we teach. You know what I'm saying? So with 36 days a year, what could you really teach your kid in that little bit of time? So once you realize that little bit of time, you go, you know what? I'm going to shower them with gifts. We're going to go to the movies in the mall. We're going to just have a good time. So when they think of we're going with daddy, they're not think of punishments, discipline. because you have to make your mind up.
And they talk shit about that.
And so
like, you want to be the fun dad.
Yo, look, hold up. Sir looking at him out the corner of his eye.
This nigga speaking facts right now.
What I got to do with this shit?
Yeah, nigga
really speaking facts right now. So, dad, you heard that shit?
So then you tell, because I got, you know, I tell my two oldest, I got to deal with them. I pay a third of their bills if they don't bring no babies, no jail.
Yeah.
So they're 27.
I told you I wasn't drinking this shit.
Because if they get pregnant, who's going to take care? If your kids have a kid early, who's going to help out?
It's gotta be, yeah.
Your money.
Yeah, it's funny you say that because I talk to my son like every other day. You know what I'm saying? Just that man check, you know, and make sure everything's cope aesthetic. Mm-hmm. You ain't got no kids out here? All right, boom. How the job? Yep. And I always reiterate that, yo, come on, if you want that freedom, no kids. Make sure you got your crib, your whip, but you got that. Now, if you want to live, no kids right now. Don't be in a rush. You know what I'm saying? Because I know what time it is when they pop out is because I sweep right in there.
Yeah.
And it's like dad all over again.
I had
again.
The realest conversation with my son. I was telling Hoodie yesterday. So Tone came back for the day to visit. And he's kind of going through this whole struggle shit where I'm not going to say he thinks he's struggling, because if the struggle is real in your mind, it's real. Who am I to say it's not a real struggle? But he's trying to balance playing ball, two-a-days practice. Mm-hmm. He's got a 3.7 in school, you know what I'm saying? So he's doing his thing.
That's a lot right there.
But I still put this pressure on him. Like, I'm not giving you $200 a week for food and gas, my nigga. You already got a car. The school is right there. I love you, but I pay your motherfucking rent every month.
Yeah.
You good. The shit you're going through right now that you think is a struggle is you becoming a man, because all those moguls that you used to listen to on all those.
They got it from the mud.
They got it from the mud. So if I don't allow you to experience some type of pain and anguish in your circumstance, I'm going to create a motherfucking entitled child. And he looked at me. He had some tears in his eyes and he totally understood. We hugged and
it's real.
Yeah, but it was one of the hardest conversations that I've ever had, because you don't want to see your child hurting and shit.
Right.
You know what I mean? But nigga, you got to feel this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he always know he in reality is always good.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
So that's
that's what I said to him too. I said, you know I'm never gonna leave you unstuck.
Straight,
but
but I'm gonna leave you unstuck this week though. You gonna have to maybe next week
next
too.
Week too. Yeah, next
you know
month.
What I'm saying? Hey, you know, listen, like, you know, that's the hard part, you know. And when you talk about how people are always single dads, single moms, you know, that's one of my biggest things too. When we talk about single things, I be mad at women for talking about I'm the mom and the dad.
Jeez,
no, you're not, baby. You just the best mom you can be. Yeah. Because there's just like with that
shit. My mom raised five boys. She ain't never said that shit. Not in our presence.
But, you know, to specifically speak to your situation,
yeah,
that was a dad to man, man to young man, dad to son conversation that no woman could, there's nothing that they can do about that. That's you know, that's a man to man conversation. You know,
I love them shits, man.
Word up. It's just like you can't have a mom to son conversation.
Just like my daughter, she talks to my wife in a way that it's totally outside of our relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Like, y'all talk about, they even talk shit about me. So it's like, when they doing them, I have to, okay, do your thing.
I don't even want to be a part of that shit. It's like,
y'all have fun. Y'all kicking and smiling, and it's all love, but that's not how we communicate with each other. You know what I mean? Beautiful thing, though. I wouldn't know how it felt to be a single dad. That shit would be fucking, I think it would be fucking difficult.
People give
like a single full-time dad?
People give me problems, but
I mean, either or, because I split it. I had to split my kids.
I think a single dad, it's a bracket. You got single dad, and then you got a visitor.
Yeah. Mm. How would you classify
it? Yeah, that's
the
definitely
two?
Different.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
I mean, just for
I'm a visitor.
People,
I'm a visitor.
What you mean?
Like, I have seven kids.
Yeah. Damn, boy, you be humping.
Well, listen, I would like to think.
I ain't throwing it.
When you look in the mirror in the morning, right?
For sure.
And you putting your stuff on.
For sure.
And your skin glowing and all that.
For sure.
You be like, yo, I'm something like a big deal as you step out to the world, right? So if you think
they call me a.
So if you think you're amazing. If you think you're amazing.
69 God.
Right? So why wouldn't you want to make as many duplicates? If your mind is fire, if
real
your
shit.
Thoughts is fire,
my brother used to be on it.
So why wouldn't
like
you make?
Because I can't afford them.
Because guess what? In 100 years from now,
I can't.
When they got the Brookses and the this and that, like right now it's the Seals, the Brooks and stuff.
They deep.
They gonna be some Capions.
They deep.
The Capion crew.
They deep.
Yeah, our legacies. You know what I mean? If you got 10, I got 7 kids, so 100 years from now, they'd be like, oh, you from the Lucky Me crew.
That's real.
That's how it goes.
You got 7 kids. What's your...
seven baby moms.
Oldest to youngest type.
My youngest is... Montana just turned.
You said 18. 7 baby moms?
Yeah, we don't do one and done.
So how do you...
one and done.
All right, so that's a good segue, because how do you feel about females having 7 baby dads?
I think it's dumb.
How y'all feel about that?
I think it's just not a good... It's
I
just
know men, an analogy.
Listen, I'm going to keep it 100. This is all I'm going to say, and I'm going to let y'all have it. Men fuck who they can. Women fuck who they want.
Exactly.
So that's why it's their fault.
Yep.
Wait, what you mean?
Because they got the blessing of selection.
What I'm saying is we're gonna continually look at it being down on women just because of the simple fact that men fuck who they can, women fuck who they want.
Yep.
Because there's so many men out here trying to holler at all these different girls, and this is just my opinion, and I'm not looking down because it's the same. But when you look at it in the grand scheme of things, that's why people look down upon it, is because if a nigga fucks 7 girls, he had something that to offer all 7
okay,
of those
I see
girls.
What you're saying.
And it's to be celebrated.
Because he has something to offer, whether it's money, love, friendship, whatever, he has something to offer.
Yeah, he was desired.
But with a woman, they have to, you know what I'm saying? Like,
they just got
to
be there.
Yeah, like a woman, it's their choice.
That's crazy.
You know what I mean?
They have to at least like the guy.
Yeah, they have
bit.
To like you a little bit.
We don't.
A nigga will fuck a fat bitch in a second.
Yeah,
a
girl
you know
right
what
now.
Saying?
One
ugly fat girl, I'm a fucker. I'm going to get some head from her.
Right here, right now. Yo, fat girl, she's like, you're lucky. Let me get some head. She's come right out here right now. Oh, what? Yo, we got 10 minutes? I go catch the head and still go home and love my
family. Like it ain't about nothing.
Because
still go home and love my family.
Because to me, sex is like a handshake.
We don't really
take it. You meet a girl at, you know, Lando's or something. You're not going home like, I met the perfect girl, and we was taking shots together. No, her butt was fat. You want to do some things.
You want to get that. So, you want to get that.
But then the homegirl that's met a Capion, like, oh, girl, yeah, he getting money. So they're talking about what you do and how you can better help her. I'm just talking about how she can help me right now. Get this mayonnaise out.
I heard about that cup. I heard about the cup of water analogy.
That's the best way I can put it.
Like, I grab that cup a million times. Like, a million people can grab that cup.
Yeah.
But you'll drink the water. But if a million people dip their finger in the cup, in the water.
Hell no.
Just think about it.
That's the first time I heard that.
When the baby comes out,
that's the funniest I've ever heard.
The moms normally get the kids. So like, I just had this conversation. The more the responsibility is more on the woman, because if you're gonna get left with the baby. So if it was us, so like to go back to the initial question of what's the difference between a visitor and a single dad is like, say the mom or crackhead, and then the dad has to take everything. He's going through the motions, DSS, right. And you see him with the baby. Strap, he's walking through the town. I'm like, oh, good man. Everybody beeping horns and shit. Mm-hmm. So cool. Then you got visitors. So you got like me. I got 7 baby moms, 7 kids, and a visitor is the guys who get every other weekend. The reason why I say, even if you do got a court order of every other weekend, those 36 days, you don't feel like a dad.
Not
if you're coaching a football team.
So
right?
Let's be clear. When you say a visitor, you don't say a visitor by choice.
Default.
You say, visitor. Yeah.
You go
to
see somebody in jail, the definition
that's
of a visitor.
How it's designed for the...
Well, the definition of a visitor is being able to see somebody for a short period of time.
Yeah. Right. But that's not your choice. Your choice is to be with your kids as much as you can.
Yeah you can't, because you have to make, like, all got baby mothers.
If
it can get spooky, right?
You choice, you'd be there full time.
I don't have a baby mother. Well, I have a wife.
Well, I got two baby mom.
She was my wife before she was my baby mom.
I can say that I've never had a period raising my kids that I had to worry about anything, not even 2 weeks. Only because I always took care of them. I always put them in front of me. I never beefed with them about who they was fucking with. It was always like, I want to make sure my kids are around. I was on my shit just to make sure the kids were good. So I've never had a period where I had to like go to court, pay child support.
I went through that shit.
But
I think that has to do with the woman too a lot.
A lot.
I think the maturity of a woman and how the relationship is.
For sure.
Or parenting style.
Yeah.
Right? Let's be honest. Because if I was we all got different parenting styles. Like I said, I'm not the guy that you would think, the fighter guy. I would be, you know, having the kids like Ike and all that. But the reality is, I'm a teddy bear to them. I'm palm. D-Box and
the realest, DC. The realest niggas usually are like that with the baby.
2K, he's getting the 150. Yeah. I already got 100, or you spend 100 to build up the player. So I'm trying to build the player. He gets there. He don't like the player. Dad, let me get another $100. He gets another $100. He's got the Nikes on his stuff.
Yeah.
He's playing in the park. I'm like, you supposed to play the season. Build your season up. Get MVP. He's like, nah, I just want to play in the park. Like, so all right, cool. So my parents, so when the mom be like, oh, the kid did this or did that, I go, I'm confused because I don't get that behavior. I'm confused.
So I went through a period like that. Right. That was a wicked period. A
little bit of time, 36 days, and you get the other 300 days. How come people are influenced mostly who you're around? So if what's going on over there?
Yeah, they gain their morals.
Well, I think a lot of it too, I'm not defending anybody. I'm the devil's advocate. So if being a stepdad, I'm a stepdad. So I understand the other side of what you're saying. So I lived and I raised a kid who had issues at home but didn't have issues with the dad, and that was because she got whatever she wanted when it was there.
Yeah.
But when discipline happens, if you're not, the hard part about, and this is just my experience, the hard part with discipline is your discipline don't mean shit. You know why? Because you're not going to be there every day. And I'm not specifically saying you. I'm just saying as the other dad. So the discipline that I have to deal with every day makes the kids act a little different.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Because
the structure.
Because I'm the structure. I'm the day in, day out. You know what I'm saying? So when you, what you would call a weekend dad, and I'm not, to you, I'm just, I was in a similar situation raising my oldest child.
Because kids are manipulative, too. You know what I'm saying? Like, they can tolerate.
They're going to be great with you because you get everything you want. You get this, you get that. But
then again, I think I was telling you about how my son said to me in his late teens, like, thank you for never just giving me anything without having to earn it. Even though when he was living with me, he had to adjust to my structure. As an adult and as a late teen, he totally appreciates what he got when he was with me, because when he wasn't with me, he was able to do whatever the fuck he wanted to do. There were times that Dia Jackson called me one time when they were in Wise. He was with his grandmother, his mom's mom, disrespecting her, all type of shit. Dia shook him up like, ain't you Cap, son? I'm going to call your dad right now. Called me. He was like, Tone was crying. You know what I'm saying? Like, so he knew when he was with me, there was discipline, there was respect. Mm-hmm. When he was with his mom, it's not, I'm not saying she didn't raise him properly when he was with her, but there was a different level
just
of respect.
To go back to what he said, parenting styles too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? All that plays a part in this
shit. And family court, this is what I learned. I've been, you know, one of my baby moms in Ithaca, she was, you know, doing drugs and stuff. And, you know, I had to, once again, we going right back to why Sierra is important. Cause I gave up. I didn't. When people are doing drugs and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? I'm a street guy. You know, in the past, I sold drugs. We don't do those. I'm from that era. We sell them.
Real
doing.
Shit.
So when we find out these young people are doing drugs, it's totally what I'm not used to. We used to
kind of fuck you up a little bit.
Yeah, cause these young kids are 19 years old smoking, like, weird, smoking crack. It's the most weirdest thing. And so when you find out someone had a hidden addiction and stuff, when I met C, she was like, "Yo," she hit up my baby mom. I was like, yo, he's missing his kid, da-da-da. My baby mom called me from a private number. She was in a rehab. And that's how I learned that my son was, she was on heroin.
Word.
And Sierra's like, yo, let's make a bet. She goes, look, my baby dad, Corey, he's being a little I ain't going to say the word, little bird or whatever. And I'm trying to get visitation. When I get my joint, you got to go fight for yours.
Oh, yeah.
I said, bet. So I ain't know that the females get it quick as they go.
Oh yeah,
man, she got that. She took Corey, man, that first time they gave her what they gave her, whatever. She's like, tag, you're it. I had to go to Ithaca, fill out the paperwork, but in filling out the paperwork and all that stuff, you find out stuff and you learn stuff, and then, you know, I was like, oh snap, my son was suffering.
Yeah, that shit hurts.
The thought of my son suffering.
Yeah.
My cup?
Yeah.
That's what, like, my cup.
Yeah, I already
and
know.
And so, you know, she met Sierra, and Sierra, she grabbed Sierra's hand and took it to her tent. We had did a camping trip, and she brought some heroin, like maybe like 15 needles, and Sierra took it to the water, and she threw all the stuff in the water.
Why she throw it in the water? That's affecting the fish.
That's why my catfish tasted funny.
You know, I thought it was dope.
Yeah.
Because to this day, when Sierra passed away, my bae mom, the one who was on the drugs, she's been clean for mad long.
That's a beautiful thing.
And she's like, yo, I'm gonna take you off child support. And
word.
I was dancing.
That's a beautiful
thing. That's real, yo.
You gotta show us the dance you did, though, because I know you was getting it in, too.
That's not real. Just the basic, no, it's not just the basic. The basic dance, the happy dance. You know the dance when the food is coming and stuff. But back to the thing of being a visitor, I'm a great visitor. So, like, my parenting style, for me, I didn't want to be the come from group homes and corners and sit on stairs and do push-ups and shit. And so I said, you know what? Even though, like he was saying about giving the kids stuff for free, now I ain't no sucker dad just, you know, bring money. No, we have to create incentives because life is going to be about incentives.
Yeah.
You go to Elcor, right? I had a baby mom that worked at Elcor. If you come to work 30 days straight or 60,
I used to work there,
they give you an extra check. Because people call in so much. The probability of people calling in is so high. So the people who stay and come to work on time is far to none. So they reward that. So a couple years ago, my son is 12 now. He was 9, and he was average 76. That sounds nice to me. You know what I mean? I'm a dropout. See? That's good. But she was like, I was like, yo, look. I said, yo, I need you to step it up. We win. We smart. Since then, high honor rolls and everything. So even when, like, I get the calls that he's being disrespectful to the stepdad, I'm kind of like, I used to be a stepdad. It's a thankless job. You know what I mean? When you break up with the girl, she don't say, well, I was with you for 5 years, and you bought this ice cream for my daughter, and you bought this, and you did Christmas. It didn't work out. You should get your money back. They don't do that.
Nah.
You know what I mean? So you just go on, and then you see the kid that you was once disciplining. This happened to me all the time. Yeah, I'd be in Dollar General, and I'd be, oh, man, you got big.
Yo, we got to, I definitely don't want to cut you off.
Now you got.
Because you're giving us a lot of great content. I'm glad you're here. Very profound mind he has, I would say. You know what I'm saying?
Very.
Like, the crazy part is I could sit here and listen to you all day because you say some real shit. You know what I mean? Like, that's the only lucky me that I've ever known. You know what I'm saying?
Same.
Like, you a little crazy sometimes, but at the same time.
Your videos is a little, you know, I respect it because, you know, I'm.
That nigga's a hustler. I've seen that shit.
I was telling Cap some weird ideas the other day, and I caught my daughter wearing like a little half shirt, and so I said, you know, if I see you wearing a half shirt again, I'm gonna cut a half shirt, I'm gonna paint some abs on my belly, and I'm gonna come to your school.
I told him,
and
I'm
gonna go to your school, and I know the principal, so I'm gonna stand in the hallway during class change, and be like, "Yo, Jariah," with a shirt that says "Jariah Dad," half shirt with the abs out. You know what I mean? That would be a dope video. So I always, you know what I mean?
Like, There's two me's. You got a grown man, 42-year-old, 1982 man that you know, is a grown man and work and provide and just not a bum.
Mm-hmm.
Then you got the lucky me guy, the snow bunny guy, the guy that jumps around and have girls bounce their titties on his head.
Entertainer.
Yeah, the entertainer. Because people, remember, we're just specs.
Facts.
So how do we stay? How do we stand out? When I wear my shoes, I wear four laces on my shoes. If you go to any of my pictures and videos, you'll notice I wear four laces in my shoes.
What's the science behind that?
I was sitting over here. When
I was in Brooklyn, my mom used to get it. We used to get when it was a fire. My mom used to come go out there and pick clothes out the fire that they gutted, and then she'll wash them in the tub, and then she'd be like, y'all pick what y'all can wear, and then she'll get you throw me sneakers. And I remember it was a pair of Patrick Ewing, the all white ones with the strap, but they were two sizes shorter. So what I used to do, I was like, man, my feet was balled up.
You take the soles out first?
Took all that out. Yeah. And so I noticed if I wanted to be cool with my friends, I let the laces loose, and then I'll be like this during class. Let my dogs breathe to the day.
Oh, yeah, I've been there.
And then when it was go to lunchroom, we here with it.
Matt Bogachik, this nigga promised me a pair of Jordans. He was going to
I
booth.
Remember that name.
Yeah, he used to be nice at ball.
Yeah.
Nice at ball.
When that man.
Yeah, so I was at Divin, sixth grade. He was at Booth. We used to always go to see my pops, like, on the weekends and shit. So we was at Booth getting busy. That's when everybody was over there.
Yeah, man.
So he used to always have the new J's. Long story short, he was like, yeah, when I get my new pair, you can have these, right? That nigga got that new pair. I ain't never seen them old pair. So I went to that nigga house.
Oh, that's right.
His mom came to the door and all. I said, excuse me. Matt told me that he was going to give me a pair of sneakers, and I haven't heard from him. And Nigga came to the door like, what are you doing here? I was like, yo.
I came to get them sneakers, nigga. Told me.
He gave me the motherfucking J's.
Yeah, I would have too, nigga. Your motherfucking ass show up at the crib by yourself. Talking about, hey, yo, Miss Mom, tell your son to run them sneakers, my nigga.
No, in hindsight, I think his mom felt bad for me because I was fucked up. You know what I'm saying? But it was a pair of them shoes that the motherfuckers ain't fit, so I'm walking around.
Yeah, he had low feet.
Little ass feet, son. Yeah. My feet still fucked up to this day from them J's, man, because I wore them shit so they couldn't.
But it just reminds me too. Once I started to, you know, getting moving and making a couple dollars,
yeah,
and I was able to purchase shoes and stuff. I just always wanted to remind myself. My oldest son, he be trying to mimic me and all that. I'm like, you can't be this. You can't do this. My oldest one, you know, the oldest one. I was gonna actually do.
It's always the oldest. Bro.
Do your kids wear your shoes?
Hell no, my kids is.
Are you clothes?
Nigga, I bought my son some shoes. He wear the same size as me. I told this nigga, it's over.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You know what it is?
We gonna switch off,
nigga.
None
of us wear the same size. Like, like clothes-wise, they definitely can't fit my clothes. Shoes-wise, my younger son, he's like 6'4", wears a 13. My oldest son wears a 10. I can't squeeze in a 10. So
I have a son that's 6'4", too.
You know what I'm saying? I'm an 11 and a half, 12.
I'm like, where you get that height from? You know what I mean?
Real shit, man.
Where you get that height? I'm short.
And them niggas get fly, man. I wouldn't even want to wear the shit they be wearing.
Nah, I remember.
It's too flashy for me.
A couple months ago, he had these Air Maxes on.
Which
I came
ones?
In. The colorful one.
The blue and red and white
one?
Yeah,
I said, let me find out you done stole your son's shoes.
Yo,
they look just like one of they. Listen.
Now, you know what it
them
is?
Them look like a pair that he would have.
Deshaun has those shoes.
Okay.
If I could wear his size the way he discards shit, nigga, I'm taking your shit.
Yo, Cap.
Because he's disrespectful with shit.
You said Tone wear a 13,
yeah.
Right? I wear 13. And I know he a Kobe fan like me, so
man.
I got some joints that's on ice that he can take because I ain't going on there.
He'll,
you know what
he'll
saying?
Definitely
he
be
gonna come knock on the door like his dad.
Yeah, I'll bring him shit. I'll bring him shit.
I text him now. His ass be here in 20 minutes.
Yeah, he'll be hyped for them shits because I look at them shits.
Just
sitting there.
That's some real shit.
I heard Lucky Me buy sneakers too, so I wear size 13.
You a 13?
Yeah. Well, I'm a 12. I'm a 12 and a half. But they don't really make a lot of 12 and a half. And I'm not going to get the 12. So, like, I wear two pair of socks sometimes just for
because.
I mean, if you tied your laces up, they might fit. Them just look big as a mother. I'm like, no, damn.
Because I'm a 12, so I got a space, you know, a whole foot. I don't think we should just wear our size. Like, if you 11, you
Lucky,
should have a little space.
Keep in mind, I think we may be traumatized and have a little PTSD when it comes to shoes based on having to squeeze in some shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And that nigga said, I ain't never going to feel that shit. Real shit.
Remember recess, you playing tag and all that?
Yeah.
The fast dude, the girls are sitting on the side, man, with their little stuff. And like, you trying to run, catch people. And one time, I got a funny story. Because being that, when I think of, when I see your situation, I think of Deion Sanders. I'm a big Colorado fan. And so when I was young, I asked my mom.
Deion Sanders he's an amputee.
His toes.
He got
his
toes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yep. His big toe.
He got to get massages and blood flow and things in his foot or whatever. He be showing it and all that.
Word?
Yeah, it's on YouTube.
I didn't know that.
Yep, it's on YouTube.
I ain't looking at that shit. I don't like when that nigga send me shit.
Last night at the wedding, in the last picture, I took my leg off for the thing.
Nigga. I'm like, this nigga is extra, boy. That shit was dope, though. Man.
And so he had the ones with the Nike going across the strap. So I told my mom I wanted those. She went to
the Deons.
Deons.
Those was the shit.
So she came home. She said, I got them sneakers for you.
Nigga.
Man.
I would have fucked Matt Bogachik up for them shits.
I opened the box. Instead of a Nike check, it was a lightning bolt.
Oh,
my mom
was
the attack forces. Remember?
She tried.
Payless used to always be
the
forces.
Yeah.
So
my
she's like,
mom took
they
me to Payless before thinking I was going to accept it. And
look, just like them.
Yep. And
they're the same thing, the same baby. Thing. Just put them on.
So next day in recess, I'll catch you. Because I got the new joints on, so I'm running
that
around.
That nigga ran through them
and my
shit.
Whole, we had dirty clothes anyway, so I had dirty socks on with the new Payless joints.
Yeah.
And I did a stop, and the whole front ripped
that
off.
Shit came
and
off.
My whole sock.
Oh, no.
And they had to take me to, they had to tape it.
R.I.P. to them souls.
Yeah. I got one wear out those, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, man, that's tough. Day.
But I ain't gonna lie, these motherfuckers at Finish Line had me feeling, they had me like tapping back into some old school shit like that. I don't know if you guys remember the high tech boots.
Yeah.
So I wanted some high tech boots. It was the same shit. Bob's couldn't afford the high-tech boots, but she took me to Payless, got me some shit. And I knew they wasn't high-techs, but I was like, fuck it. They look, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Wore them shits to school.
Ain't nobody gonna check and say.
Well, I ain't gonna lie, a few niggas said shit, but niggas knew I was violent. So niggas been like, yo, what's those right there? And niggas kind of put it out there that they knew and let it go, right? And I just had to. I just had to hold that shit.
He said, shit, you might want to take them off.
That's so, that's so whack, though, man.
Signs is dope.
I mean, I can't, I was that guy. I'm that guy right now. I mean, you know, just the pick on guy. So that's why I'm over here being quiet. Like,
you would have got poked the fuck up in eighth grade, nigga. Straight up.
You know, I was that guy because I was that guy. You know what I'm saying? You figure Fredonia is like a private school almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, nigga, I went to school from Fredonia from
probably
fifth
a lot
grade,
of money out there.
From fifth grade until 12th grade. And I had, I can name every black and non-white person that I went to school with.
So he was like Will at Bel Air ass.
Yes. No, wait, just about that. He only had a Carlton.
Shit, maybe that's where you developed
that.
Your comedic skills because
that's
you,
why
it's
I said
a survival.
That's why I said it's a defense mechanism. That's what it's from. It's from being having to be defensive and always, you know what I mean, feeling like I'm attacked from different, you know, angles.
And you got to make the white folks feel like you're not a threat.
Yeah. Feel comfortable.
Yeah, yeah. They don't feel comfortable, they attack, and their attacks are different. You know what I mean?
And I can relate. Cause I was in a group home with 18 dudes, you know what I mean, from 12. I was, many people don't know, but I was in a group home. I was in the same group home as DMX, Children's Village, in Dodge Ferry, New York.
Okay.
And so we had cottages. And so you had to deal with different personalities. And so I'm mad little. And so you have to be witty and funny to get the older guys. And if you're the funny guy, they'll protect you. You know what I'm saying? Or it'll get you through certain doors or keep people off your back. And it is me becoming funny, keep people off your back. And obviously, you got to know how to fight a little bit, too. But if you got those components, the funny component, people want to come around you. And I learned that even when I go to jail. You know what I mean? If you got a decent personality, you can play cards, whatever, you'll get through your bed pretty
Hell yeah. I had to tell
smoothly.
Some young niggas at McCormick, like one young nigga actually in a group, because he's about to go upstate. So they all know I've been up before. Yo, Cap, did you ever get into some crazy? I'm like, yo, look, you go there, you mind your motherfucking business. You don't be gambling. Don't be borrowing shit. And you just be a generally good person, niggas ain't worried about you like that. All that other shit is on the TV. You know what I mean? You get into weird shit, you're gonna get some weird shit. You know
but
right?
But sometimes, you know, you can just be minding your business. I was in Fishkill, right, on work release, and I was short. You know, you don't tell people your time and all that. I'm short, right? And so I'm going to the mess hall, and you know, when I go outside, you know, I hit the pole, pause, and you know, walk the joint or whatever, do my push-ups. But you know. The Mexicans got the El Telemundo TV. You got the black people watching BET. The white people watching CMS, the country stuff. So I'm just next to a dude that's from Mount Vernon. And we just shoot, oh, you like Free, 106 and Park, whatever.
Everybody like Free. That booty was big.
The next day, I get surrounded by like 10 bloods. And it's like, yo, you was next to that dude with the glasses in the yard yesterday, right? I was like, yes, my man. He's like, yo, what you claiming? I was like, I ain't nothing. He lying. Niggas about to serve me, right? One of my guys I used to get money with in Rockland County, he just happened to be on his bed and he seen me. He was Muslim now, white boy. He go, yo, Luck, that's you? Save me. No boy's gonna tear me up. I might even have
shit, I ain't never had no
encounters
like that. Like I was, you know, mad prisons, mad time with wild niggas. I have never had any issues like that. Like one time my homie DV, God rest his soul, he was a 5-star desperado. He was high ranking in Orleans. I used to always be around him. Niggas knew I wasn't blood, but I think I told a couple of y'all the story about when he was beefing with the Jamaicans.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was cool with I still talk to the dude Shy to this day. I think I showed a few of y'all some of our communications, but we were all in the same dorm and they was beefing. The only issue that could have arose from that Vic DV was like, yo, I'm a fall back from you a little bit because we're warring and they know I be around you, so I don't want you to get dragged. But nothing ever happened, you know what I mean? And you know, I seen niggas get poked the fuck up, stabbed up,
left them alone,
cut up. I seen Vic chop a nigga face up, but not one time did I ever feel like I was in harm's way at all, because I wasn't on no fuck shit though. Like I wouldn't stay up late and gamble. These niggas be out there. I see niggas have to pack up from owing niggas debts and shit like that. But I minded my business. I read. I worked the fuck out, and I was always big as a motherfucker, so that probably played a role in the shit, too. And I was just a cool dude. I wasn't on no, like, unruly shit.
Being funny, though, sometimes it gets you in trouble, though.
Hell yeah, niggas don't know how to shut the fuck up when you funny.
Word up, because I done got myself into some situations.
What are you talking about?
I done got myself into some situations over some bullshit. Just like, just associate with a nigga. And so now I met you, now we chilling. And then your people come up, mm-hmm. and they try to, now we cool, though, you know what I'm saying? And your people come up, and then they say some slick
shit.
Yeah,
but you look at people, though. You get this look where you, like, you literally will look from top.
Size a nigga the fuck
to
up
bottom.
Oh, yeah.
Looking, scanning niggas and shit.
Nah, it don't even be that bad. Yo.
No, bro, you actually do that.
You can't really see it. You can't see it, fam. You can't see it. But, yeah, that's funny you said that.
He does that.
Yo, Dev, it's not that funny, brother.
Nah, he does that, though.
You really don't know.
I really don't.
That's what you do. That's a normal shit.
And that's when I be like...
Bro,
chill,
go
son.
Like this.
That's exactly
what he does. Yo, that's a whole fact.
Do that shit again.
That's exactly what he does.
Gotta get correct, boy.
Yo.
You got a neural link in you already, nigga. Be scanning like a motherfucker, huh? Yo, so who sent that baby oil video? Because me and Lucky was talking about baby oil.
I think I sent that.
I'm going to play this video because we had a dope conversation. See, this nigga's perspective is totally different. On the whole baby oil shit. I don't know what's in the video, but if it doesn't touch on what we talked about, I'd like you to break that down to them.
Yeah, because I have my own scenario, too. That's when I seen it. I was like, oh.
Yeah.
It's not $1,000. People get caught up with the numbers.
Maybe you should tell them before we play the video, I'll play it after.
Because I want to say my part, too. I just think there was drugs in it.
Yeah,
because that's why the niggas took it.
That's the shit that they put inside the drink.
So they actually took the baby oil. Think
they confiscated it.
Yeah,
I don't think they're that lazy.
Lazy what?
To put everything all in one, all for one special. I think they have cocaine for when they want to do the cocaine. They got the weed for the weed. I believe
it wasn't that type of drug though.
No,
it was like a
the cocaine that they had was fire. The street stuff.
I'm talking about the baby oil.
I know, but the baby oil
GHB.
It's. It's nothing.
That shit.
It's nothing. It's.
Is that a lot of it?
They said. They said it's. The lawyer said something about it appear what appears to be baby oil. They didn't necessarily.
Oh, they didn't say it was.
They didn't necessarily say this is baby oil. No, they said what appears to be baby oil.
You would think that by now they would have some form of testing done, though.
I mean, you think by now that
but they might
all
be
these people
it
that
for
and
the
they
speedy,
probably have to test right. every single bottle.
Y'all do know it's oil. That you can spray your stuff with that keeps you like this. Y'all do know that, right?
Nah, yeah. I'm just on
once upon a time, you know,
just the honey packs.
Before they had, you know, the cameras and stuff, you know, you come in the building.
Yo, text me and tell me what
people leave their boxes, and I'm young, and so I'm coming upstairs, caught my man box on the second floor. So I come upstairs, she's like, what's that? I was like, I just booked this nigga box from where the paws from the thing, whatever. So we crack it open, and it was like some furry cuffs, and it was the spray.
Freak box.
Right? 69 guard, right?
Yeah.
So I used the spray. Long story short, my girl was addicted to it. And when we ran out, she was like, you can't go get more, like, type deal. Like, I used that to say, like, let's just say hypothetically, it was that type of, you know, they have stuff that warms when girls, I don't know if y'all guys get massages. I get massages 3 times a week. From these local Elmira
three times
girls.
A week.
From these yeah, local.
Nigga, text me about that too.
No, because well,
what he was nah, what he's really telling you, what he's really telling you, can you give him back his package that you took from the apartment?
Hold on, wait. Tell me as men, y'all don't get We buy cigarettes, we get beer, right? We say an eighth or some loud, $30 at best. If you smoke, you probably smoke once a day, whatever. If we can give the weed man $40 for some loud. I can give a shorty $40 to rub my body down for 40 minutes.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's what I do.
For sure. I would do that quick.
That's what I do with the little thing.
My wife ain't trying to hear that.
They got the little thing up top or whatever where you can kind of put, no, I'll be like, who I make?
I'd probably do it $50. More than that, too, especially as sore as I be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I'm a grown man. Like, we having a grown man conversation, and there's some young guys, you know what I mean, that don't believe in that type of shit. But, nigga, I go get massages. I'll go with my wife. You know what I mean? She'll get a pedicure. I might get a pedicure. I can get, you know, they got mad at me when I asked them, can I get half off, you know what I mean, on my pedicure, because I only got five toes. Let me get it for $17.50. You know what I'm saying? They ain't like it too much, but you know what I'm saying?
You
like,
minimum, you got to pay that, bro.
But I'm just saying. I mean, because this one, I could take this off and just clean it with, you know what I mean, a Clorox cleanup wipe, and it'll look brand new.
You be putting polish on that one, too?
Nah, my girls try to do it for my birthday.
You be filing it down and shit?
Nah, but you know what I'm saying? Like, I do that, too. Grown people shit. Like, nigga, going to get a massage is...
Well, I'm all purpose. Her girl buys me massages from now.
Yeah, that's my spot.
Well, I'm all purpose. And I cut you up from fighting and stuff. So if I get into a fight,
you go whoop a nigga ass to go get a massage?
No. But what happens is you win the fight, but then when you go inside the house, Sierra should be like, I'm gonna get the ice, right?
Yeah.
Because
I'm
hurting more.
Yeah.
When the door's closed, I'm like, I'm jumping around, moving. I'm 42.
Adrenaline is down.
My knees start to swell up. I won, and I'm in the house like this. Listen, I told you, start trying to be cute.
Listen,
so that's why I get the massage
at a cost.
Listen, I know that for a fact. Before I lost my leg, I had went to go work out a couple of times with my cousin Sky, and I went to the Y, and you know, I got done working out, and I'm shooting over on the other side, and you know, I'm feeling like I'm going crazy, like boom, boom. I'd have hit like 5-6 in a row. I'm like, oh shit, nigga, this is just like this, like, you know what I mean?
And bad.
So the kids was like, yo, old school, nigga. I got my earbuds in. I'm over there. Boom. I know they ain't talking to me. They see this. They see the dream shake. Old school. I was like, damn, who the fuck is y'all talking to? They talking to me. Nigga, I got knee braces on. I smell like Bengay. My outfit don't look right. You know what I mean? They said, we need one more. I said, you know what? Talking about old school. I said, I'm about to bust y'all ass.
Yeah.
Boy, listen, I played so hard, right? It was point game. I said, yo, point game, game. I had to make it because I didn't know how much longer my body could take it. So I made it. It's like, oh, I picked up my bag. I walked
out of Dodge, huh?
Nigga, I got to the side of the building, and I was on the side of the building like this. I was like, babe, I'm on the side of the building. I'm going to be here for a minute. I can't feel my legs. Because I had to get away from them niggas. Because I was like, y'all not going to call me old school. That adrenaline, like you said, that adrenaline, I was hooping hard as a bitch.
What's that school by Southside Pudgies? That little...
Parley Culver?
Yeah, Parley.
Yeah, I promise you. Like 3 months before Sierra left to go to Texas, I like to train there by myself, right? It's quiet. My knee, for some reason, when you get these ages, your knee just pops off for no reason. My knee popped out.
Oh, shit.
I'm like, yo, you got to come get me, Sierra. She had to carry me. I'm hopping or whatever. And then when we get to the house, it pops right back in. So when you say, like, you be feeling it. I'm like, because my sons, too, they be talking crazy. They be like, yo, dad, this and that. I'm like, I was a problem. I'm telling you, you can't do nothing with this.
Yeah.
Like, the one thing all my kids, I could beat in the race still to this day.
Nigga, I still talk that shit. We used to work out at the Y. He's like, yeah, we should play basketball. I said, nigga, you don't want none of this.
But he's one of them physical niggas. One of them niggas that he'll push you, throw
yeah,
the elbow.
I got to do what I got to do now.
I don't play dirty, bro.
I don't play dirty, neither.
That's dirty, nigga. You like... 300 pounds. You can't throw a light elbow. The fuck?
The shoot jumpers then. You know what I mean?
You can't.
Shoot
it's not
jumpers
possible.
Then. Man, play the video.
All right, let's see what this is. Yes. Who sent that shit?
I can't hear it now. That's just like that's like the hot tour girl. She said, "Yeah, you know that song."
That shit got me.
Why y'all do Justin Bieber like that?
Yo, Justin Bieber's going through it right now.
Are you in the group chat
on Facebook?
Yeah, that's what that was.
Yeah,
that shit's crazy.
But not for nothing, the oil I think is blown out of proportion. And if you did the math on the amount of baby oil that's inside the bottle.
Oh, yeah, break it down.
Like, you guys have jacuzzis. Now, we have tubs, basic tubs and stuff. These guys got jacuzzis and big, Scarface type tubs and different things like that. Airbnbs. How much you think it'll take to fill up a tub, your tub?
Think about it.
You talking about gallons?
No, just
if you had the baby oil bottles.
Yeah,
say you went to a dollar store and you wanted to buy 1,000 of those little... cooking oil, baby oil.
Because they don't sell it in mass, like, containers, they don't,
but,
right?
But if you did, but even if you empty them out,
you think it would
probably
take?
Wouldn't even fill it up.
Nah, it wouldn't.
But we hit 1,000. It's a lot.
I mean, when you think about it,
you got to think, I threw 1,000 singles on you right now. You're like, oh, all the money.
So what if he was doing something that we just don't do with the baby oil?
So the money. You go to the strip club, you can have $1,000 bills and say, one for you. One for you, one for you. But if you got the 100, you got the 1,000 ones in your hand, you're like, yeah. It looks like a lot. You right. Throw it in the air, it's raining. You throw the $1,000, it just hit it right in the glasses. That's it.
So are we saying the baby oil was possibly used to in like a hot tub? Like
my baby mom, my first baby mama, she from, I used to live across Bronx and Castle Hill. She came to my house one day. I had a futon. She had two plastic bags. She gave me scissors. She said, cut them in half, and then you tape them. I said, for what? She said, I did it. Boom. It made, like, from here to here.
Damn. This
we ain't no plastic. We ain't had no Home Depot money to get the regular
disclaimer,
plastic.
He a freaky-ass nigga. So, he a 69 dog.
I ain't never heard no shit like this. I got this.
And then she said, I'm going to try something new. It's my first baby mom, my black baby mom. I like her. She all right.
So, what's this timestamp, Jed? I gotta tell my wife to watch this. We about to put some plastic on the bed.
So she gets the traditional, every good family underneath the tub or something or under the sink is that one that's been there for years. You may use it once and twice or whatever. She put it all over the thing. And she said, now, you know, Bruce Almighty, get naked and you get on there.
Bruce Almighty.
So now I crawl on there like I'm about to get a beating. You know, you're about to get a beating. So I crawl like I'm about to get a beating. I won't do it again, mama. You remember that was work. So I get on there, she hit me with the oil, whatever, and then she started putting on herself, and we had a good night. The moral of the story is, when I thought of the oil, I said, Nicole was on to something. My baby mom's. This is when I was 21, I'm 42 now. So I was like, oh, he's just one of those. Because think about it. If you had someone to clean it up, and you want to, when you do it, you and your wife slipping and sliding, and you're like,
so that's what.
Around.
So they was just using it for the freak off.
Exactly. And if you guys ever took a girl, y'all had sex on a waterbed, anybody?
Nah.
It's the same. See?
He too young for a waterbed. He don't know what a waterbed is.
Do they make waterbeds still?
I don't know, I used to have a joint from Endicott that
You missed out? You definitely missing out.
I've been on a waterbed.
You've been on. Sir, what you done did on the waterbed? Sir, you've been awful quiet. He a 33 guard. He's a 69 guard.
What are you talking about? I can't talk about it.
He said he a 33 guard.
That's all. He a horny ass nigga. He a 33 guard.
Yo. I just want people to think like that's just leftover for the next party. And then he'll probably get another shipment. And then, because think about it, if say we wanted to throw do a 50 cent thing and do like a summer jam for out here, but like with a pool party and stuff. If you got connections to unlimited bubbles, right, the bubble machine, we're gonna utilize that. Boom. If he got the oil connect, whatever his baby mom's work at the oil joint, he'd be like, yo, where they getting it? Oh, all you gotta do is get your joint. They're getting them from this in Dakota. All right, good looking. Hit him off. Now we getting the shipment. We got the bubbles. We got the stuff. And when we doing this thing, collectively, we put our resources together make a great event. So for him, that's Mr. Party Animal, right? He's been partying for years and years and years. Yo, we doing the oil with balloons and stuff tonight.
Yeah.
And the bikinis. Yeah. That's all that is.
Like it had to be some shit.
Biggest thing about
I don't really
that
care about his freak
though.
Stuff. He could be freak.
I think the biggest thing about that oil is the stuff in it, though. Like, people are, like, the 1,000 get your attention, but that's a, like.
But this is the thing, though. So think about it like this. If the bottles were this big, because we don't know what size the bottles are.
Like
so what if there was 1,000? What's 1,000 of these?
Mm-hmm.
I think we should allow the nigga Diddy to explain to the world.
No, I understand what you're saying. I'm saying what you're saying. You saying is that there's something
in the question of the decade.
In May, we're going to find out.
Don't even need that May.
But what I'm saying, but I understand what he's saying, too. What I'm just saying, what you're saying is what he's basically saying is what you're saying isn't wrong. If there's something in it, it's fine. But when you hear 1,000 bottles, you're picturing 1,000 of the, the old school joints that our grandma used to have.
Yeah, that's what
you're
picturing
1,000 of those. Yeah. But it could have been 1,000 of these, and we 1,000 of these ain't shit.
They make everything smaller now. If you look at it, right?
Well, it could have been even smaller because you got
1,000
the
little water bottles.
The travel ones.
See, we don't know.
Yeah.
That's real.
And then you'll be mad. You get the evidence, you get the discovery, and you realize the how small it was, and you'd be like, I'm in this man business, man.
Sometimes I feel like that.
That's real.
So let me segue away from the baby oil, because I still use Johnson & Johnson, and I don't want to sit here and disrespect the product. I want to get your guys' opinions on this video. This is related to Elon Musk, right? I don't know if it's going to play the whole thing, but I want to see what you guys think about it. I'm not giving up any hints on what it is. It's nothing too crazy, but
I think I know what it is.
I'm going to play it for you.
I think so.
Hold on, let me see. So I have a surprise for you, which is that we are going to be awarding $1 million to randomly to people who have signed the petition every day from now until the election. So, you know, one of the challenges we're having is like, well, how do we get people to know about this petition? Because the legacy media is won't report on it. You know, not everyone's on X. So I figure, how do we get people to know about it? Well, this news, I think, is going to really fly. So every day between now and the election, we'll be awarding $1 million, starting tonight.
So what this is, he has a petition, right? And he wants people to sign the petition related to the Second Amendment. And the fucked up part is, because, you know, as soon as I seen this, I was like, nigga, I don't give a fuck if I believe in what the fuck your petition is. I'm signing this shit anyway if I get put in a drawing.
For $1 million.
Yeah. But it's only for swing states. I think it was like Arizona, Pennsylvania.
What is a swing state?
A state that
has a large quantity of electoral college votes.
Basically, the votes in these states are what's going to determine who our next president is. Yo. I was mad as fuck when I seen that New York wasn't on that shit.
So, like, the neutral state, basically? Like, a neutral?
It's not neutral. It's they're high. Basically important states to win the election.
So you know how they basically say that the electoral college votes is what wins the election. So the swing states are states that are big enough to where they have, like, 36 votes. I can't remember exactly how many off the top of my head right now, how many it takes to win the presidency. But if you get these specific amount of states, so a state with the population of, like, Pennsylvania will have 36 electoral college votes compared to a state like Delaware who might have 4.
Gotcha. I see what you're saying.
You see what I'm saying? Because of the so swing states.
And he's for Trump, right? Elon Musk?
Yeah.
That makes sense when you think about, you know, the throwing out of money.
Yeah.
So what's this petition about?
I want to say it's, I'm trying to find it right now.
Why don't I ask how this nigga, I'm like, what's the swing state? Jetta go like this.
Jetta ain't been on camera the whole time, man. Put the camera on you one time, Jetta.
That's some slick shit, too.
He ain't been on one time. He done had it on the box. Pause. He had it on the four square.
I ain't been talking.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what
true,
y'all thought
true,
of that.
True, true, true. Tell him, Jetta.
Jetta, what do you think about that? Put the camera on you and tell us what you think about that.
I don't think shit. I don't give a fuck.
I don't know. I don't really. That's a lot of people are going to be signing for that. So I don't know how many days is in between this and the election, but.
A couple weeks.
Only a couple weeks of people getting money. I don't give
a
damn
about
that.
A lot of money. A
lot of money.
Free.
But that's a lot of people. That's like.
So wait, what is the petition?
I'm trying to find it right now. I know it's related to the Second Amendment.
I'm guessing to uphold it and keep it.
They're trying to get rid of that shit.
Yeah, because I think
with Biden, they're trying to compromise it.
With Biden, they're trying to remove guns in a mad different level, especially with the ARs and things of that nature. Man. And I think Trump is pro guns.
Yeah,
he wants Americans to
have more guns.
That's my nigga. That's my nigga, man. He for the people, man. Shit.
You guys voting?
I'm voting. But the Second Amendment, right, I do think that there needs to be more stricter things on firearms, because it's not the fact that you can't bear arms. I don't give a fuck about that. But it's just like with anything else. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I mean, it's hard to
say. They make this shit hard for niggas to get it, though.
I think it's strict right now.
Because in ours, easy to get it done, but legally, it's hard as fuck.
When you go to Georgia, you go to Georgia, you pull out your ID and be like, yo, this is what I want. You come back the next day, you got a gun.
Yeah,
you can't do that in our state.
Not New York,
but in a lot of states, it's easy to get them shits.
Well, I encourage everybody in my family to legally own your weapons
responsibly, though.
Yeah, yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Like that's the difference, I think, and that's the only reason why I say something about the gun thing is because there's certain people that don't need guns. Look at all the school shootings and all the different things. I'm not saying that's going to stop anything, you know, but that's just like anything else that needs to be regulated. You can't have so much to drink that you just get in your car and drive through a whole neighborhood. It has to be regulated somehow.
Then it becomes a mental health thing where it's like there has to be regulations on individuals with mental health problems, and then you have to screen for that if you're going to, in my opinion, if you're going to allow everybody to own weapons, you got to screen for that shit.
I just went and bought a shotgun, right? And the background check they had to give, I had to do like on a little tablet.
Yeah,
I did too.
Anybody can get a gun. I don't, them questions.
Not me, nigga.
Well, yeah. Well, like there, it's not thorough at all.
Yeah.
Like,
was it instant too? You could purchase it instantly or you had to wait a day or so?
You don't gotta wait a day. You just gotta wait for the background check.
But we're talking about, well, he's talking about shotguns.
Yeah.
You're talking about ARs. Well, that's
a rifle though.
But a high power assault
rifle and AR without a license.
Yeah, and there's AR pistols. AR is considered a pistol depending on the size of it. Just like a Draco, a mini Draco is a pistol. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Nah, shit, to take your pistol and make it look like an AR, nigga.
But
just
also,
put it in
even to go get your permit or whatever, it don't take much. It's just a payment.
Yeah.
And then the process is still the same. The only difference is here, I got my license. Then you do the background check and all that shit.
Yeah.
So it's like, there needs to be a thicker wall there.
Like, sir shouldn't be able to walk in there and purchase nothing.
I don't think I'm ever gonna anytime soon.
Good.
I'm gonna gift you with one then.
Good.
We need arms.
This pros and cons both sides, I think, though.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I think
my grandma was always strapped, nigga. Since I was a little ass kid. She always had a deuce in her purse. We always knew it. Sometimes we found it, played with it, thinking it in hindsight. That shit was dangerous as fuck. Yeah. Super dangerous, but she always had one. You know what I mean? Her and my grandpa was shooting it out at Jones Court.
Oh, shit.
Real shit,
sir,
man.
Didn't know what to say.
Real shit.
Damn.
The 80s was a crazy time in our lives, sir. The 80s and Jones Court, brother.
First unit, my nigga.
Yo, anybody know where the closest shooting range is, though?
I mean, there's a few around here.
PA one.
Gray Street, nigga.
That's the
there's one out off of Pennsylvania Ave. I can't think of the name of that shit, but you just go like all the way down Pennsylvania Ave, like you about to go towards PA.
Okay.
And so there's a hill.
Usually right down 14.
Yeah.
Right before you, right after you pass the little the car, it's Sheddings up there, but I don't know what it's called out there.
I'm thinking that if you keep moving your hands like that, we'll figure
it out.
Out,
right?
You can even stop talking and just gesture like
that. I wish I was born in a time where I knew routes, because you said right up 14.
I don't want no smoke, buddy. I seen that look in your face, bro.
But I know where it is.
Route 14, so if you go like
Route 14, I'm tripping.
Yeah, that's right over like
if you going past Broadway School, if you keep going straight, that's 14. If you go that way, it's 328.
Oh, damn, I was lost. I said the wrong road. So the PA road is 14, and the
328
one.
They
both take you to PA, though. Yeah. It's just different
directions.
Well, you know Smoking Joe's?
Yep, that's 14.
That's 14.
Yep.
All right, yeah, I was wrong. Yeah, I wish I was born in that time, though, because I asked my dad how I get here. He started spitting out numbers and shit.
Yeah, because y'all got GPS, nigga.
That,
we ain't have GPS. My granddad, we driving down
maps,
south. I had the Atlas. Or, you know, in the 90s, you got the MapQuest.
MapQuest.
And so now you got
to print.
You can't
sleep
in the passenger seat. You holding the thing like this, and it says 56 miles.
Yeah.
So now you're like, all right, it's 54 miles. All right, Dad, it says exit 7 right here. You take a right off of exit 7, and we in that motherfucker. See, you.
I thought I was a shit when my mother-in-law had the TomTom. I still got her shit.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But shit, we ain't have that back in the day, nigga. You had to figure it out.
To be honest, the highway cost, most of the time,
86. What was it called before that?
17.
Yeah, see, what?
We was thugging it out. You just get in the car and go, my nigga. Like, there wasn't even, most of the time, thinking about no maps. It was like, yo, we got to get here.
Yeah.
We going to get in the car. We going to go.
Find our way.
And just go. Somebody knew something.
Shit, when we was little, Church Street and Water Street was one ways.
Yeah,
I have a question.
Damn.
Back then, the post, like, say, like, when y'all was going to school, and y'all see how it is now.
Yeah.
I'm not from here. I probably never know what it's like to be a little kid running around here, you know what I mean, being young, a teenager.
Yeah.
Is it better? What's the difference between then and now? Is it just different times?
I think back in the day, I had a lot of fun. Like, one, there was a lot of safety around. I think that was a universal thing, though, because, you know, crack was crazy around here to the point we used to always find the vials everywhere. I was in Jones Court, so there was vials on the basketball court and the playground. But you were never in harm's way, even though there's mad fiends walking around.
Yeah,
they were still.
It was all our aunts and uncles.
To be out and about, not having to worry about shit.
I mean, being a small community, I think. So I lived in DeWittsburg, which is Heritage Park now. He was a Jones Court kid. So we lived in DeWittsburg, and we experienced the same thing.
Yeah.
But the simple fact of, in our community, because that's where we were at, we knew everybody in the courts. All of our parents were friends. So we knew all
shit, nigga, I was everywhere. I was on the south side. I shouldn't, nigga, my kids ain't never experienced the shit I did. And who the fuck was watching me? Because I was on the south side. I was
be home at 8 o'clock.
The Lord. I was,
you know how you be out all day just hungry as a motherfucker? Yeah, you don't know how you going to eat some shit.
Just making moves.
Like, fuck it, yo. We all going to run into Sugar Creek. Whoever get caught, nigga.
Best not stealing.
And wanted to ask you, Cap.
Yo.
Before you did start doing music,
yeah.
Who was the guy out here and who made you say, yo, I'm about to start doing this?
My brother Brandon, because I've literally done music my entire life. Like, I was born into a music family. My pops used to rap. My brother was always a DJ, five years older than me. So that was always there. There was never a period in my life when there wasn't music. So when we were probably, in sixth grade, I wrote my first rap that I performed. But before that, New used to be in a couple different groups. Literally, when he was DJing, he would bring niggas like Kevin Newman and Pyquan and Corey Simpson in him,
yep, and his brother,
back to our crib. He would wake us up, make us come downstairs and perform the shit that he wrote for us when we were in elementary. You know what I'm saying? And then from there, you know, we just started writing our own shit. That was literally sixth grade. So it was my brother New. Pyquan took me to the first official studio. Not official, but with the dude he be with, Phil, I think his name is.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Keys, the dude with the do-rag and the glasses.
Yeah.
Walking around a bike.
Glasses look like this.
Yeah, and then Dodo actually took us to our first official studio session at Pyramid Sounds in Ithaca.
Yep, I remember that.
I remember when Dodo, not to put his business out there, we all know, but that's when he was on his shit.
Yeah.
He was in there peeling off. That shit was like $150 an hour to the point they wouldn't let us touch the boards.
I remember that.
Nothing.
That shit was lit.
Lit. So, yeah, there's always music.
Always be wanting to know, man. I be wondering when people get around you, do they ask you where it started? Do you, because with music, right, some people do it and they stop. That makes me so mad when I see people. I'm like, yo, you don't do no more music?
Yeah.
You don't do that no more. What do you mean you don't do it no more?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Yeah.
Even if you just keep it in the top.
I can't stand that.
What do you mean you don't do it no more?
Since I come from it, so the evolution of me, you know, now I work with kids. Not only do I do sessions, but I work with kids in a state facility 3 days a week, and I get paid a lot of money to do that, right? Mm-hmm. Now, I do sessions with them. I teach them audio engineering. But if I would have never stayed down in my passion, it wouldn't have evolved into me getting a state.
Right.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But
windows wouldn't open.
Yeah, so me not doing music was never a part. So I went from being a rapper to an engineer to a producer to a little bit of everything. It was always music. You know what I mean? How about yourself? Because you've been at it for a long motherfucking time, too. You got the most views out of everybody.
But by accident.
Because you from Brooklyn, but if you've been in Elmira this long, you kind of an Elmira.
When people ask me where you from now, but I'm from Elmira now.
That's peace. That's peace.
It's where you've been the most. And, too, I love it here.
Yeah.
I love it. And so when I see people be like, oh, the black hole, well, then sign me up then.
Word
up. I mean, because it's not even, just like you said, I say I love it too.
Me too.
Because it don't matter where you go, but what do you want out of life?
I own my own home.
Some people ain't never lived anywhere else.
I got
either.
A wife. We've been married for 18 years. My kids, you know, they make their own choices, but they healthy. We working on and managing family values. Nigga, that, you ain't met nobody. You ain't met nobody that been more places than me.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? And so,
fuck your passport.
What's not to be happy about? I think if you're not happy in a place, it's more or less your choices and what you're around and what you choose. And it's affordable.
We're walking over the bridge. There's little things like Madison Bridge, the bridges that they got, right? Anytime you can be mad creative, you don't got no money, get a little slice of pizza.
Yeah.
You can get your little honey dip. Over the joint, you got the little water, you got the greenery, the broccoli and all that.
Yeah.
You get, let's take a picture right here, boom, create a moment. Hold a hand. Now we got all this technology. You got her favorite songs, playlist on the phone. You rocking, smoking your little blunt or whatever. And you got that. In New York City, you got to go down to Chelsea Piers and go to these different places.
Yeah, but you got to be careful walking over the bridge now. Them homeless people will run up on you. You know what I'm saying? Oh,
they deep out there. I ain't going to
lie. Them homeless people out there, they'll run up on you. Oh, let me get that pizza, nigga.
When I went to go pick up my truck the other day, I got an alignment at, what is it? Is it Mavis or whatever the fuck that is over by the pizza spot? Mm-hmm. Nah, right around the corner. I had to walk through the park downtown. And when I'm walking through the park, you know, I just be on my naturally. Then I'm like, why are these niggas staring at me like that? Like, there was like seven of the motherfuckers down there looking at me like, what is this nigga doing?
Walking through my crib.
Get out my crib.
I ain't want no smoke. I was just observing and kept it moving. But I actually told my wife, I said, yo, it's crazy because I've been down here for 8 years. So it was nothing like this when we first set up shop here.
Uh-uh.
And to see the shit evolve into what it's turning into, where is it going to go in the next
When we came down here, we were the people that they were looking at like that.
Yes.
You know what I mean? That's why we came up with all these rules. Like, I used to smoke cigarettes. And I wouldn't even smoke cigarettes in front of the building.
That's why,
you know what I'm saying? I smoke weed. Now, we're not doing none of that in front of the building. You're not sitting in your car.
I got blamed for every fucking thing. I don't even smoke weed, and the nigga was blaming me for weed. Like, nah, man, the fuck? Like, now weed is the least of his concerns and worries. Hey, Kurt, do you think you and your buddies can keep the door closed? Because, you know, homeless people go in the bathroom and they're in there washing up. And sometimes I leave that shit open. Like, I don't give a fuck because they ain't hurting me.
Overdosing and all that stuff in the bathrooms.
Sitting on the floor. Tell us about your videos, bro.
Well, all right.
Which one got how many views?
This is what I want to ask. How do you choose the women that are going to be in your videos?
Listen.
Depending on the mood. So, like, I'll meet somebody, like, say, like, you think sometimes it's more hate than love, but it's more love than hate. Because people ain't going to, if somebody don't like you, they ain't going to tell it to your face.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you'll hear through. And then you still don't respect it. Then, because you're like, all right, cool, whatever. Talking about me, promotion. So, like, say, like, I'll give you an example, Thank God It's Friday, right? Well, I'm Burger King.
Mm-hmm.
Outfit and stuff.
Pajama pants.
Yeah. Yep. That was by accident. One of my licks worked there. She quit. So she's like, this is the last time I'm come see you for a while. I quit. And my brain instantly, like the way my brain works, capitalize, utilize the people and things around you. I'm always thinking about that. Keyword, utilize, not use in a negative.
Being a resource to someone is a good thing. I taught my kids, my boys that, like, if a motherfucker needs you for something, that means you're resourceful. You're a resource for them.
You got the studio. Embrace that. People who try to become friends with you guys to get next to him for what he got.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Value.
Oh, I know.
And so, you know, like, when the girl, I go, all right, cool. Then people are challenged. I like challenges. Oh, you can't. Why don't you make a song about getting your paycheck on a Friday? And what you want to do? And that's your word? I can't do it? You'll put this. I get in a random beat, and I feel it. Boom. And then I go, yo, give me that. I'll give you a half. Give me the shirt. Give me the hat. I say, yeah, we gonna shoot it. My baby mom used to work at Elcor. She used to always tell me that all the girls used to be questioning. It's like, you really like this? Do we got money? Is he really crazy? Is he really this? And then there'll be those hidden fans. Oh my God, I love him so much. And they'll befriend my baby moms. So I used to use my baby mothers to get the girls.
That's real.
Oh, that's dope.
Staying connected to what is. That's what I see. Like, you know, motherfuckers is trying to be in your circle to a degree.
But only for that little bit.
Yeah.
They're a dick ride for that little bit. So I already know, I learned this when I was in jail, tell lies through vision.
Yeah.
Television.
Yeah.
So when people come and they trying to,
I said, all right, cool. You're trying to get something from me.
Yeah.
So it's a race.
Mm-hmm.
What can I get from you before you go on yeah. the rest of your life?
Mm. Yeah.
So you're going to kiss my butt? I watch your videos all the time. Yeah. When's the last time you watched? Oh, it was this one. Nope, I did 50 after that, so you one of those.
Yeah.
So, okay, cool. So while I got you all bubbly and jumping around, I got 150 for you. What I got to do? Just dance around. There's people don't know me here.
That's dope.
They know you. That's dope. That's such and such from third graders to Eater Bookers. That's what's the name that peed in the bed at camp. So, boom, when you watch the video and you're like, all right, it's not high quality. Who is this guy with the nose jumping around? So, but we know her. Hey, I saw you. You see somebody dollar. I saw you in that guy video, the new guy here. Yeah, he paid me, girl. He didn't make me do nothing. Got a little $30, no tax, and he didn't even use all the footage. Word? What he be doing? He buys stuff, he sells stuff. Now they're adding me. That 150 is a commercial. White people, they'll put an ad on the news, Wink 101. You have to pay for that. Commercials, you got to pay for that stuff. To get you to say, Lucky Me got the best phone covers, you don't know if my covers are good, so you're like, I need 500 if you're going to use my likeness. Mm. It's the likeness of the people. It's not me. You don't want to see me all the damn time.
Right, right.
Remember we were talking about, and I want to, shout out to Chirk, when we was talking about Chirk being mad nice with the bars and stuff, and he's like respectfully speaking, he's like a great value.
Fred
the Godson.
Yeah.
It's still good.
Yeah.
Fred the Godson is nasty.
Yeah.
And so you say, all right, why people don't champion? People supposed to be chirk. But girls and kids like me. And when it comes to that, when the girls look at Chirk, they're like, oh, he's sexy. Are you saying he's sexy? No, this on me. He may have girls that think he's sexy, but from the masses.
Right, right.
Our
right.
kids looking at him like, yay. Think about Kai Cenat. Yeah. Kids love him. The girl has the cute factor for the girls. He has all the stuff. Yeah. So as much money and music that Chirk has done for the area, the strides he did, meeting, bumping shoulders, going to the city, putting in the work. The people here ain't gonna be like, yo, we gotta salute this guy, even if we don't like him, because he's putting on for us.
Right.
Right?
I mean, that's just local support in general, you know what I'm saying?
But if he had the oomph, if he had the face.
Aesthetics do play a big
part. Yo, yeah, that's, with anything.
You also gotta think about this area, because you're a math guy.
Mm-hmm.
The majority of people here are white people. Not to say they don't support hip hop, but when they have shows at Tags, no matter who it is, it's filled with white people out there having fun that'll never listen to the music that we make. They just don't support that. So the small urban population we have is dealing with the regular shit that happens in every other city. It's just a small population where you'll get a certain amount of people that'll support it. But since it's such a small amount of people, it doesn't really make waves.
Yeah, you're right. It's, Elmira, if you Google Elmira's demographic, it's 73% white people, 22% black. So just take that 22%.
And then break it down.
West Main's music is street.
Yeah.
East Side, good tracks. You know what I'm saying? Touching Shoulders, Hell Row, going down there, good solid music. Maybe half of that is paying attention. Half of the 22%. Yeah. And see, half of that, half of them is just listening and not even being a fan.
You know what the crazy part is, though? Say, even if a nigga stepped out of here and blew the fuck up, that's when all them white folks and people in general would champion you and hold you up. Like, come back to the community. Then they'll come out the Tags and watch you perform.
Yep. Right.
But not on your come up.
They won't help you get there. They love you when you're there.
They talk about music and stuff. To me, since I've been out here, the guy, like my I got favorites. And the people who got it, I think Rick Root is the total package. Pause. He's the total package. Jim Franklin, he's the total package. Whatever.
So much fucking talent out here.
And so,
sound like the end of the world out the smoke.
Yeah, I wake you up out of sleep. You got to take joints to wake you up. And so, when you got people like, if they were to battle.
Who would you say is the most popping artists in your opinion, not based on numbers, but who is like, because everybody's doing
for the
their
whole
own
time
thing.
I've been here, or they got sections?
Currently,
it's been quiet. It's been kind of quiet lately. I've been thinking about stirring some stuff up after I get done with this case, because it's just been it's too quiet for me. And when it's quiet, I like to stir stuff up with battles and different things like that. I just have to poke at the bear. We rap. Let's do it. That's like the basketball court. Get on the court, play 21.
Yeah.
And then I could lose. It's cool.
You know what sucks? Seeing so much beef going on in such a small place, man. Because, you know, I've known all these dudes since they was little kids. And then to see the dissension between a lot of them, that shit breaks my heart. You know what I'm saying? Like,
no dads.
It's crazy.
No dads.
I mean, because, you know, when you think about it like that, too, and when you talk about the music scene, when you was asking earlier about the influence of him in music, what a lot of people don't realize is when you think about it like this. So back in the day, we had the Shady Villains.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that's not just the people that you equate, you know, Alley Cat, all the different cliques of people in music that you can think of all come from this one tree.
Yeah.
I mean,
shout out to Alley Cat. I like Alley Cat.
But you know what I mean? You know, they all come from this one tree under New. You know what I'm saying? Like,
he was the one.
There's eight different cliques, and there's different people doing this and this.
Recordings. There was a point in time where he was the only one you could go to.
Yep.
For beats, recordings. He's DJing everywhere, so to perform, and that was a lot of fucking weight for that man to carry. But
what up? Shout out, you know, shout out to Brand New, man. R.I.P.
R.I.P. Love you, man.
To answer your question though, this is my two favorite. If I had to be on an island and I had to pick two Elmira or maybe one Elmira artist to always listen to, it'd probably be Rick Rude. He always been that guy to me since he was little.
He's never had a whack period, like when he wasn't nice.
Because when I came up here, I was writing stuff for got his name, Pig Son. I named him Quarter Water. And it's like, there's this other guy that you probably don't have to write for, but he's good. And then seeing this kid, 13 years old, with a book bag, smoking a blunt, walking down the street. And remember, I'm like, who's letting this little kid smoke? And then I was like, yo, he's like, I heard of you. I was like, I want to write for you. He said, I don't need to. And he started rapping for me. And I said, he's cool. That's what my son, I would want my son to be, like the Rick Rude type. He's like, got the cold
shit,
cool.
When we performed at the arena, he was like one of the little kids in the stands.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah, I don't know how old he was, but he was about 3 feet tall. You know what I mean? Yeah. He was a little ass kid. I'm like, yo.
I like that kid. That I was wondering why nobody with big money ever just, you know, grabbed him up and just set and did put. And that's the problem, I think, sometimes. Because that happened with, shout out to my guy, Young Prince, because he's a beast. I don't care. No one said Young Prince is nice. And so when Prince, we had parted for a little bit and he was with Double Edge, I was wondering, I was like, dad, why don't those guys just put Prince in the front?
Yeah.
Because he's the young one. That's how you do it. You feed off the young energy, and then you reinvent, and then you got Sharp. He sounds like Nori. He's nice, Sharp. Once I got a chance to listen to Sharp, I was like, oh, he's good. And then I was like, oh, but let Prince, youth. You lead with youth, and then you come slide Sharp back in there.
Strategic.
You know what I'm saying? On those soulful hooks he be singing and different things like that. And that's why I was like, yeah, you'll be back, because they're not even doing you right over there. A lot of people don't know. They got a song with Jay Hood.
Mm-hmm.
That's because of me. When I got Prince, Prince had just got out of jail, and he had came to my store, and he had did a hood. I was doing a thing called Hood Talent in Elmira, to where people come to my store, and I'll pay them to get their talent. Like, it's boring up here, you know what I'm saying? So Prince came, and he was just talking that stuff. And I started working with him, and I said, for my type of rap, I make fun rap. You need to get with someone. If we're going to do something, I think you and Jay Hood would be nice. Called Jay Hood, had Jay Hood on the phone. We was talking to Ithaca. Salute to Prince. Prince went and told him.
He getting married in a couple weeks.
Yeah. I told him I wanted to do the wedding singer, man. I wanted to be the wedding singer, man. But he, you know.
Yeah, like 2-3 weeks.
We might be performing. We got a song called Can I Be Your Man? That we might, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, if I get past this case, I'm going to go down there and support him. But Prince, if I had to pick, Prince ain't from here no more, but either Jen Franklin's the new guy that I like.
Jen Franklin.
I don't know who that is. You got to tell me who.
Every time I see that young man, I tell him to stay sucker free and keep your ass out of jail.
They got a crew named Zooterville or something. Zooter something. I just think he got the look. He got the.
He's never had a whack period either. I remember.
And he sing.
He's always been held up high when it came. I've never heard anybody say they didn't like his music.
I like him. I like him. His dad came to see me, and he was like, I see you. You know what I'm saying? We got a song that we did with the Scar Kid, what's his name? Zaire?
Oh, Zakai.
Zakai. And so people always give me stuff. I say, y'all want to see what I look like under the real light? And we did a good video with me and Jen Franklin. But as far as like the videos and stuff like that, my favorite, don't be the ones that people like. Like the Thin Guys Fridays, all the weird ones, Bitches Call Me Daddy, the ones and all those different things and stuff like that. Those are fun, but
Y'all can't never say nothing bad about me ever again. That nigga got a song called Bitches Call Me Daddy. You know what I'm saying? And y'all say I'm crazy. Like, that's some shit that I might even say
that. I was excited because I was like, yo, I'm in this town and there's no men. So even if you doing a little bit, you get a lot. And the ones who ain't doing nothing, they get something. But if you got something going for yourself, you tower everybody. There's no ambition.
Clout chasing.
So, like, when I saw it's a plethora of women, these single mothers, you can go sit down in the DSS early in the morning.
Shit. Yeah, I mean, you know.
That nigga a sniper.
This is what you can do. I'm going to get some game.
I'm not going to lie, because that's why I asked you how you chose the women in your video, because I ain't even being funny.
You got some Samantha in
there? Cause some of them shit, cause some of them girls in there. I was gonna say, now that you say in the Samaritan Center and DSS, one. You probably did.
I ain't trying to cut you.
Liz is ready to go.
My daughter just texted me and said that she's gonna call me soon. She's on the train. We don't get to speak as much as I'd like to. It's always a FaceTime, so y'all niggas can stay down here and do whatever the fuck you want. But I got to answer that call when she calls.
All right, man. Yeah. We got about 10 more good minutes. Anyway.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
You guys,
I wanted to give a shout out to somebody too, Cousin Krills.
What he been up to?
He's an amazing guy, man. Let me tell you what this guy did for me. He's like, so through the years, people thought that we had this thing, but we really respect each other and stuff like that. And
what thing? You gotta keep in mind, we don't
rap,
know.
Music, rap stuff, like, cause I'm
rap. Rap beef.
Like rap stuff. And so if you're doing music,
yeah.
I'm competing with you.
Oh, okay.
So, like, I'm just competing. Like,
Chirp, healthy competition.
Yeah, like, Chirp just did one with the mic thing.
I didn't.
Some new video he just did.
Was that on YouTube or Facebook?
It's on YouTube. Anybody that do music in Elmira, I'm on it.
Yeah.
Watch it.
See, I don't really tap into any music that I don't record or work on.
I look because that tells me, yo, you playing around. Somebody else trying to creep up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They playing around. Like, so if someone, like, I got the joint from Chirp. So, okay, Cherry popped his head out. I like that. Nice song. So that'll tell me to do two joints. So I already hit. I got a joint coming with just for competitive circuit. So when he see, he be like, oh, Lucky. Oh, you still around, Luck? All right. Let me go back into the thing. And so, with Krill's solid dude, I got into some trouble. Obviously, you know, my brother was having sex with two of my baby moms. And so the WETM said that, you know, I put hands and feet on him. Left him in the street with a crowbar. Whatever. That's what they say. We fighting that right now. Got a lawyer. You know what I mean? But I'm sitting in jail, and I couldn't get to my money. And Brown, you got bail. I come out with my normal people from across the street. Krills heard what happened. He came in and he bailed me out. If he wouldn't have bailed me out, I'll still be in jail since December 7th. And so,
December 7th. That's my day.
A lot's happened since then.
Give that nigga some applause, goddamn. Yes. That's some real shit.
And even, and speaking of Krills, going back to the time when my house got robbed or whatever, he came and he was looking at everything. And shout out to him. I was like, Sierra had $200. She just got paid. And so she's like, listen, I gotta go to work. You better take this $200. You know how to flip money, make it do what it do. And so she's like, I'm not leaving you. So this is the ending of why she's amazing. She didn't leave me when things got spooky. She believed in my ability to get everything back.
Yeah.
And I did in a month. We had 4 new TVs, 55-inch TVs at the time. This is back then in 2015. And when Krills came, I said, yo, C gave me some bread for this. Krills said, put your money in your pocket. Gave me the QP. He said, that's on me. So, like, when it's all said and done, people, like, if I beat this case, I'm going to get, like, a Krills tattoo, a Cousin Krills tattoo, because I was able to see my newborn walk and different things because he allowed me to get out. And I asked him, why did you do it? He was like, yo, I always had a respect for you. You just do whatever you want. You have fun. You just kind of be yourself. You're not scared to be yourself. And guys like you need to be free. And
that's real.
That's super real.
I cried, man. I cried and all. I was like, yo, because we lived this life. And our family members, you think that our family members is going to hold us down. Like, say if you get locked up right now.
It don't work like that.
You think Cap going to come get you. He going to come get you.
Oh, he going to come get me. I'm not going to lie.
That's what makes him solid.
I'm not going to lie to you. If I got locked up, my wife going to come get me first. But then she going to call him, and they going to come get me together.
But if it's a situation where your wife can't get and he's around, you know he got you.
Yeah.
See, people like me, with all the fakery always coming at me. You think you got all this people, right? And mm-hmm. then stuff happens and people kind of, and then when you get someone that you don't even imagine.
Yeah.
And they save you. It's and you be like, and I go, yo, and I say, yo, what you want? I give him the money back. Obviously come free, you know? And he goes, yo, I just made your friend. And this whole year we've been bonding and he's been checking up on me every single day, my mental health and all that.
Dope.
Shout out to Corey Keller, man. Cousin Chris, man.
Shout out to Cousin.
Salute.
That nigga motherfucker. I remember when back in the day we used to host them parties and that nigga was mad skinny. I ain't seen him for a couple years. And he was like, yo, what up, Germ? I'm looking at this nigga like, who is this motherfucker? I said, that nigga got his weight up. He came in. I was like, damn.
And through the years, right?
He got his weight up.
Every time I went around him, you came up.
Real shit.
You helped him get the A Mafia joint in the city or whatever. Because he's always sending to me, like everything, cap. You were his Dr. Dre.
Yeah, I was.
You know what I mean? If it's like Eminem type of deal, you was his Dr. Dre.
I was there with them, man, the Fly Boys. And, you know, even when niggas was hating on them, because I'm not a follower. You know what I'm saying? I do what I do. If I feel, I move off of me. Niggas was hating for a while. They picked up a little bit of motion. Niggas started falling in line. You know what I'm saying?
And even when that movement came, I was like, oh, hold on now. They doing stuff. Remember, you had the snapback on there.
Yeah.
And it was clear. And he had the perfect setup. He had the videos. Had you with the clear quality.
Yeah.
So I got the shitty quality. Because a lot of people don't know, I recorded off my not even a mic.
Yeah.
I don't even use a mic.
The headphones or some shit?
Yeah, just headphones.
Yeah.
And a little hole at the top of my mic.
You can make it do what it do, man.
So I just wanted, on a public platform, if I don't wake up tomorrow, I want people to know that if I beat this case, if you see any fun things in the future, Chris made that happen, and I want to publicly thank him.
Good luck with your case too, man. Yeah, man. When you said that earlier, I actually typed it in on the on Google shit.
Oh, you saw it, right?
And it popped up.
Yeah, it's a real deal. They offered me 11 or whatever. I'm not taking 11. I'm 42 years old, and I got kids, and so I can honestly say it's 80-20. It's 80 I'm gonna win, 20 no, but it's getting a little closer to 90-10 because if my brother don't show, you know how this thing goes.
Yeah.
If my brother don't show, the case go away. And so hopefully, you know
when
what I'm
do
saying?
You find out when you got to go back?
Well, I trial jury selection is November 12th. And so it's crazy, but the baby mom, when I came home, I didn't stop taking care of my son.
Yeah.
Right? And so what I did was, we're going to use the word manipulation. To manipulate is to be able to control people and things around you in a smart way. Right? So if someone say, oh, you're a manipulator, it doesn't mean it's a bad thing.
It's not always a negative thing. It's everything only when you use manipulated.
It. It's only when you use it in a bad sense. You know what I'm saying? So, like, what I decided to do is keep my eyes on them.
Yeah.
And so I said to her, I said, listen, it's not about how you start the race, it's how you finish it. And, hopefully he'll make it, allegedly. Hopefully he'll make it. If he don't make it, we'll be back here celebrating. I would love to come up here and get wild.
For sure. For
and
sure,
celebrate. Man. Because 11 years is a long time.
Yeah, that's a threat, right?
Especially
there.
When weed is legal and stuff.
Word up.
And stuff like that. But mainly for my kids. My kids, they need their daddy. And you know what it's like for you. You be a strong man to be an example for your boys. Because I bet you his friends don't have no dads. And you probably helped his friends for years by being like kind of like a secondary.
Oh, I got nine 13-year-old girls right now. You see me in the mall, I be with 9, 12, and 13-year-old wild children. Them girls run me ragged. I love them, though.
Yeah, shout out to Chris, man.
My house was the house that all the kids was at. But that's how my mom raised us, though. Mm-hmm. Our house was the house. Everybody could be there. You're going to eat when you're here. You know, you can stay tonight.
You're going to get whooped because...
You definitely going to get shaken gonna get up. You're going to get whooped. Bullshit.
I got whooped. I remember the first time I got whooped was when I was trying to do... Remember when Roy used to do the backflips in the... in Jones Court. In Jones Court, we was all in one bedroom.
Run up a wall and do a backflip.
So,
off of that karate shit we was talking about earlier, because my dad taught us martial arts at a young age, but when you used to watch those movies, then you get obsessed with shit they doing it. I'm looking at Roy like, you fucking crazy, nigga. I ain't trying to flip off no goddamn wall. But he literally was running up them bricks, flipping, landing that shit and all that, bro.
That nigga did it. He did it in the crib. He ran in the closet and did a little flip. I said, I can do that. Nigga, my whole back was in the thing.
I got my ass whooped.
I ain't never tried that shit, son.
Fuck that.
Mama, I tried to whoop my ass, send me home. My mama whooped me,
nigga,
too.
I landed on my neck, son. Wesley, oh, nah. Wesley Schuyler. He was gave you, now you do the Russian
yeah,
flip.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wait.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So on three, we were supposed to do the, right? And I was successful at Russian flipping all the time. This nigga didn't pump on three. So I'm still trying to jump back. And he didn't push.
Oh, shit.
I was like,
straight to the neck.
Landed right on my neck, nigga. I'm sitting there on the ground. Motherfuckers laughing at me.
Nah, that's why. That's why I played ball. Fuck all that.
Yeah, I played ball too.
A little acrobatic, little nigga.
Yeah.
I couldn't do no flip off a wall, though. I tried it once.
You ever flip off of anything?
Yeah.
Like a railing or?
Railing.
We was on some air
bars,
shit,
all that. But I tried to flip off a wall one time. So you're not supposed to push off. You're supposed to hit it leg straight.
Yeah.
I learned the lesson. But I ain't do it again, though. So.
Nigga traumatized.
Huh? Right. I flipped off a screen. I slipped off a swing and broke my collarbone.
I
that used to be
that,
the
though.
Shit, too.
When you get high enough on the swing and then you flip off that shit.
I used to see niggas doing it like, that looks cool. That looks cool.
Keep going, bro. You got it.
Shit, man.
God damn.
I ain't do that That's swing
funny.
Shit.
It's funny y'all bring up, not to cut you off, my son, he be watching Cobra Kai or whatever.
Yeah.
And so to me, I'm old school, so I'm with the classic Mr. Miyagi, right? So I was like, anything spinoff, it'd be whack. You know what I'm saying? So
they don't know.
But every time I'm taking him to get a haircut, I give him my phone, he be watching the Cobra Kai. I'm like, yo, it's fire. He's like, yo, dad, you gotta watch it, it's going down. So I finally just started to watch it. That's funny I mentioned it. Cause it make you just want to be wax on, wax
off. Come on, man.
Nobody look at you. Know
Listen,
what I'm saying?
See, they ain't grown enough. See, they ain't grown enough. So I'm talking to this side of the room right here. I got to talk to this side of the room. Cause y'all not. For what I'm about to say, y'all not grown enough for this conversation. Y'all remember back in the day when you seen Breaking. You know what I'm saying? Like any of them joints, Breaking, Enter the Dragon.
When he was on the roof,
see, now he's trying to violate.
It did something to me when he was on the roof.
The Last Dragon, nigga. The Last Dragon.
The Last Dragon.
You are the Last Dragon.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? You don't know nothing about Bruce Leroy.
Oh, shit.
You know what I'm saying? But what I'm saying is, the go of what he was saying is like, these movies were cultural movies for us.
Yeah.
So when we watched Breaking in the 80s when it came out, or when we watched the original Karate Kid, and we watched like the Bruce Leroy's and these movies that you guys deem culturally, we lived that. So after watching The Last Dragon, my nigga, all of us was at home like, you know what I'm saying?
As soon as that shit went off,
man, you know how many times
the wrong motherfucker test you when that energy was moving. You know what I'm saying? Because you would have did one or two of the moves correctly.
Especially wrestling. Back in the day, called Hogan.
Facts.
Remember Ultimate Warrior with the shirt off?
Hell yeah. You ever wrap your arms up?
Oh, yeah, with the things, with the fake muscles.
Yo, hell yeah. Shoestrings around your shit.
Niggas run around looking like dope fiends and shit.
How do you niggas got strings around?
Now, you watch, I'll be trying to watch it now. You'll be a little 20 something bunny. You watch WWE or whatever? I'm looking. I'm like, nah, it ain't.
Oh, shit, got an answer.
It ain't the same. Yeah, I'm about to go eat, though.
Word up.
All right,
yo. Well, listen, episode 67. Hey, Lucky Me, we appreciate you stopping
Word
by.
Word up, man. Brother. Thank you, brother. We got to have you back soon, man.
Can I get some shout-outs?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, first, I'm going to give a shout-out to my new bunny from Binghamton. She's been treating me well the last 60 days. I appreciate you, miss. You're doing a good job. Shout-out to the boy Krill. Shout-out to Jim Franklin. Shout-out to Rick Rude, man. Always show me love when I see him. Shout-out to, what's the young boys that was grabbing money? Oh, 03K. That's who I forgot to give a shout-out to, Mike. Y'all know O3K, yep. Right? That's my guy. I'm very proud of him. And Elijah, those are my two little young boys that I used to always give dollars to, and they're doing good. They got their business and stuff, and they're doing well. Who else? My baby mom's taking me on child support. I appreciate it. I need it.
Salute to that.
Mindfulness, which is the practice of being aware of your thoughts and feelings in the moment. Mindfulness.